How do you describe a wah-wah pedal to somebody who doesn't know what it is?
Wacka, 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 wacka. Wah, 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 wah.
The fabulous new Crybaby pedal opens the door to a variety of great new sounds. Here's how it operates. The guitar plugs into the Crybaby pedal with a standard cord. Then the pedal plugs into the amp with another cord. The entire foot goes on the pedal. By rocking the foot back and forth, we get the Crybaby effect.
Well, if someone didn't know what the wah pedal was, of course, the first thing you'd say was, have you ever heard Shaft?
You think of 70s porn. You know, there it is in a nutshell.
Wackadoo, wackadoo.
This exciting moment that I wasn't looking for. And all of a sudden I punched this thing in and I got something that I didn't know I had.
I would hit a note and I could feel the roll of the people just rise like, they'd come right up with the note out of their chairs.
The wiki wiki,
waka waka waka,
quack quack quack.
It goes to the heart of what human communication is kind of all about when it comes to transferring that communication to an instrument.
But it just looks like a gas pedal on a car, and instead of making the car go fast, it makes your guitar sound like a voice.
And it goes wah, wah, and it drives you nuts.
Wah, 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 wah.
Wah, wah.
The wah, wah was a quiet kept secret at the time. A lot of people didn't know what was making that sound. They just heard the sound and was like, damn.
You know, the 60s were a time of amazing change, and I think that helped set the tone for what the wah-wah entered into. And it was invented really in the late 60s just in time to be part of the changes going on. And it wasn't just changes in recording studios, it was changes in the attitudes and the power of the artist.
In the 60s, guitar was hugely popular, but it had reached kind of a plateau, I think, with a lot of pop bands doing kind of the same thing.
My guitar heroes from the late 60s and early 70s, they invented the instrument. Guitar didn't sound like that. You know, before Jimi Hendrix, guitar was a different instrument. Guitar didn't sustain like it did before Hendrix. Guitar didn't feed back before the way Hendrix did it. And one of the ingredients that him and a lot of the people that followed him, not just stylistically, but just in that time, that great magical time, used a wah-wah.
Prior to the wah-wah pedal, in the 1950s, guitarists pretty much had tape delay. And they had tremolo. As things progressed and moved into the 60s, guys had spring reverb. And then they had fuzz. The origin of the wah is an interesting story because I think it is one of those kind of accidental effects. Steel guitars give us some examples of the earliest vocalizing effects for the guitar, an example of which is Alvino Ray in the early 1940s. And then we have Chet Atkins, who recorded some things with a kind of phasey, wah-inflected sound. When I asked him once about how he got that effect, he said he just used the tone control on his guitar. English session guitarist Big Jim Sullivan likely made the first recording of a wah effect in 1961. He may have used just his volume and tone controls. It's not really clear how he got the effect. And people would have to wait until late 1966 before a real wah pedal was developed. It starts with the relationship between Thomas Organ and Vox and a guy named Brad Plunkett.
My name's Brad Plunkett, and I did invent the wah-wah pedal. That was one of my things that I take some pride in. I went to work for a company called Thomas Organ Company when I was 18 years old. The president of the company, a fellow named Joe Benarin, who was a real entrepreneur, made a deal with Vox in England to allow him to manufacture Vox products in the United States. And pretty soon we were doing engineering on Vox products.
Now, the other kind of thread that it bears some weight is there was a guy named Del Casher who was working with Thomas Organ Company in Sepulveda doing some demo work. He was employed by them at the time. And Del Casher was, I think, the first guy to ever be recorded using that pedal.
When I came to California after college, and I was busy working with everybody from Gene Autry to Lawrence Welk to Record Dates to Motown, and one day I got a phone call, and they said, I'm with a company called Warwick Electronics, and they're buying a company called Vox, and we're going to have a big amplophonic orchestra called the Vox Amplophonic Orchestra. Electric trumpets, electric saxophones, electric flutes, and we'd like to have you play guitar. And he said, by the way, this is no fly-by-night organization. It's owned by Warwick Electronics. Warwick is owned by Whirlpool. And Whirlpool and Warwick Electronics also own Thomas Organ. Every one of us had an amplifier in front of us. At this point, the Vox UK amplifier was the Super Beetle amp, which was a tube amplifier. Warwick Electronics, Thomas Organ said, we got to save money on these things, so let's cut the cost on all this. So one of the things was they noticed a little funny switch that said MRB, the mid-range boost switch.
And the switch was very expensive, about $4. One day I was talking to my boss, and he was wondering if I could devise a circuit that would allow the mid-range boost to be tuned with a potentiometer, which only cost about 30 cents. I worked on it for a while in the morning, and in a relatively short time, I had a parallel tuned circuit that I could change the frequency of by rotating a potentiometer.
And what Plunkett did was come up with a circuit that would basically, it was a sweepable EQ, and it just took one pot to do it, and it was brilliant.
So I went next door and asked a friend of mine, John Glennon, if he would plug his guitar into the pile of wires and resistors and capacitors I had on the bench. He strummed a couple of chords, and I turned the knob on the potentiometer, and it went whack, whack, whack. And we looked at each other, and I won't tell you exactly the words we said, but we said, wow, this is really great. We started thinking about, well, how's the guitarist going to be able to operate this thing? His hands are already busy. And there was a Vox Jaguar organ sitting in front of one of the other engineers' benches. So I said, hey, John, go steal that expression tube, volume pedal, from Frank's organ. Let's put the pot in there. Pretty soon we were drawing a modest crowd, and everybody agreed that it sounded pretty good, but didn't really know how good it was going to be.
The origin of the name was they were fishing around for something to call it. And somebody at Thomas Organ said, it sounds like a baby crying. And they just turned it around, became the Crybaby.
If you take a look at the wah-wah to a guitar, it's much the same thing that a cup mute does to a trumpet, in the sense that it changes the acoustic cavity in which the sound resonates.
Yeah, the way the wah-wah works essentially is a filter. And it's a filter which is the shape of like a peak, like a mountain. It lets certain frequencies through, but it blocks all the others that are on the side. And depending on the position of the rocker pedal, you move it either down in low frequencies or up in high frequencies. And it's just like your mouth, too. It does the same thing. Your mouth changes shape to produce different frequencies.
The next day, the president of the company sent down word that he wanted to hear this thing. And he said, that sounds like a Clyde McCoy wah-wah trumpet thing. And I thought to myself, what's a Clyde McCoy wah-wah trumpet thing? But
found out later.
And he called Clyde McCoy, and he said, can we give you some money and we'll use your name? And Clyde McCoy was living in Louisiana somewhere, and he said, hey, fine with me. That was it. That was the beginning of Clyde McCoy and the end of Clyde McCoy, other than the fact that Clyde McCoy's name went on the bottom plate of the wah-wah pedal that was commercially released. And he said, this would be perfect for the trumpet. And besides, we got the Vox Amplifonic Orchestra. We have four trumpet players in there. We can have four wah-wahs for the trumpet players. We can have four wah-wahs for the saxophone player. Wow, we could sell maybe 12 or 14 wah-wah pedals to these Vox Amplifonic Orchestras. And I said, no, Joe, you don't get it. I said, this is really a guitar thing. So would you let me make a record? So I got my guitar and I got my prototype wah pedal, my only one here, and I wrote the music too, and I used a drummer and I played all the parts myself. I want to describe what the growl of a wah would sound like, what blues would sound like. I thought I covered everything. I even covered the sitar. So I'm so pretty pleased to have been the pioneer of seeing the vision and hearing the vision. And that's why I made the record. And it still sounds good to me today. And I'll let you be the judge, but I think it's pretty good.
So the funny thing about the beginnings of the wah-wah is when it first came out, there was really two wah-wahs, the Vox wah-wah and the Crybaby. But everybody thinks that they came from two separate entities, two separate ideas, two separate companies. And in fact, they weren't. A lot of companies, even today, make products which seem like they almost compete with each other, but they really don't because they're made by the same person. It doesn't matter if you buy Vox or buy Crybaby, they still were made by the same company, which was Thomas Organ.
The Vox wah and the Crybaby were exactly the same product from the standpoint of the circuitry and the nature of the components inside. The reason for the creation of the Crybaby was that there were contractual relationships between Thomas / Vox and our dealers, which would preclude the possibility of the Vox product being sold through other outlets. Within about 3 months, the thing was in full production. And we built some of them there in the San Fernando Valley. Then the production was moved to a factory in Italy.
Thomas Organ went to Echo, this company in Italy, and Ennio Uncini was the manufacturing manager at that time. The people at Echo decided they didn't want to make this pedal. So Gen was created by Joe Benarnon and Ennio Uncini, and J was for Joe, and EN was for Ennio. So they produced all of the Vox pedals and along with the Crybaby pedals for a while.
And that's where the majority of the wah-wah pedals that I think people, at least historically in terms of collectors, have been looking at.
Jennings Company in the UK distributed it for Europe. Thomas Organ distributed them for the United States.
So they applied for a patent about 3 weeks later in February after I had released the record. When you apply for a patent, it takes about 3 years to get it approved.
Once the circuit got into Italy, people started copying it, and I think a lot of the offshoots were just a direct result of kind of letting it out of the shop.
Thomas did not enforce the patent. It may be that by the time the management realized that it was important, everybody was making them and it just would have been too much of an effort to try and shut everybody down.
So the wah-wah was, to me, the new voice of the guitar. And I said, this is it. The older school of producers and musicians really did not see the value to using the wah-wah pedal. I didn't see that happening until the younger players started coming on the scene, and then they started using the wah-wah pedal, and music changed.